As avid viewers of the channel know, I'm into measuring the intelligence of computers. Today, we're going to talk about how crossword puzzles are solved by computers, and this might give us some better ideas how to measure artificial intelligence. Before, we talked about how question answering becomes harder when there is more than one question in a conversation. Indeed, the holy grail of artificial intelligence is for a computer to pass itself off as a human in an extended conversation, the Turing test. That could be a dozen conversational turns, but a crossword is even more than that. A New York Times crossword can have over 100 clues that aren't part of a conversation, but that all interact with each other. If you haven't seen a crossword before, the basic idea is that there are across clues and down clues. Across clues go from left to right in languages like English and German, and down clues go from top to bottom. Whenever a down clue intersects an across clue, the letters need to match. Now, this is a kiddie crossword puzzle that doesn't have too many intersections. In a more advanced puzzle, there are very few squares that don't have letters on them. And these squares have to be symmetrical.
And let's talk about symmetry. It's not horizontal or vertical symmetry, it's rotational symmetry. So if we flip the board upside down 180 degrees, the black squares will be in the same places. So if I take a black square and place it here, I keep the symmetry by placing one there as well.
This isn't important for how computers solve these puzzles today. There are a number of features that solvers don't use, such as how a response can only appear once in the grid. But I mention these properties because one, it's cool, and two, maybe it's important in the future. Maybe it's something that you could incorporate into a crossword solver. Let's take a look at a more challenging puzzle. This is a big puzzle and it's too hard to read. Let's zoom in on the top right. Again, there are down and across clues. When I do a crossword, I typically look for things that are unambiguous, things that I know cold. In this case, it's 13 down, Judd Apatow. So let's put that down as an answer. And I think I have a guess for 12 down too. Duds can refer to either clothes or something that doesn't go over well. It also has the nice bonus of rhyming with Judd in the previous clue. Kudos to Sam Esersky, who wrote this puzzle. Let's see if fashionista fits. You can't see it, but it does. So let's roll with it. I still don't know 13 down. Eggs don't go over easy. They like hard eggs. Let's move on. Maybe we can get some ideas from the across clues. Preferred in slang starts with FA. That could be fave for favorite. And Donkey Kong is an ape. Haha, so now it's clear what 14 down is. A vegan doesn't eat any animal products, so eggs wouldn't go over at all, so that must be the answer. Many of you watching this video are computer scientists, and this should raise the computational complexity hairs on the back of your neck. This is a massive constraint satisfaction problem. This is the kind of thing that can bring computers to their knees, because there isn't a polynomial time algorithm to search through all of the possibilities. Indeed, this isn't even NP hard, it's P sharp hard. So can computers even hope to solve a crossword puzzle? For today's crosswords, the answer is yes. However, I'll talk about how I think we can craft crosswords that are impossible for today's computers at the end of the video. I want to start our discussion off with one of the first papers that tried to tackle solving crossword puzzles, a system called Proverb. Proverb looks a lot like Watson. Lots of different submodules to process answers that were scored based on how well it filled the grid. But that's not the most lasting contribution of Proverb. The most lasting contribution of Proverb was how it handled the dependencies between the clues. But before we get to that, I need to point out the awesome first author of this paper, Michael Littman. He has a much stronger YouTube game than I do. You start a search, but training error that you minimize won't generalize. You overthink.
overfitted.
Here he is singing about overfitting, and his machine learning lectures with Charles Isbell are awesome. Check them out. But getting back to the main story, the lasting contribution of Proverb was creating a bipartite graph that express the links between the clues and the cells in a crossword grid. So the bipartite graph has two sides, clues on the left and cells on the right. Here I only have the clues that interact with the blue shaded cells. Let's number them 3, 6, and 9. So now the next thing to do is to connect up the cells and the clues. 3 down covers all of the cells. 1 across's last character hits cell 3. 4 across's last character hits cell 6, and 5 across's last character hits cell 9. Now we've drawn those lines. This encodes that if you make 3 down the, then 1 across can be that, but not eb, because cell 3 cannot be assigned to both T and B. At this point, you might be wondering if you actually need the clues. Perhaps with a dictionary, you could just find some words that make the puzzle work. Nope. First, this makes a search space much more difficult. You couldn't solve a puzzle fast enough to compete with humans. And not all of the answers are in a dictionary. Look at the examples here. MMYY isn't a word, but it's a reasonable answer for a credit card expiration date. Likewise, Snoisnioino only makes sense when you rotate 180 degrees to spell moon mission. So you need to accept answers that you haven't seen before and that aren't real words. Again, if you want to compete with humans, you need to be able to produce these answers too. Even if a computer can't figure it out, it needs to accept them as possibilities. And that was the goal of Dr. Phil, the next step in the story. Dr. Phil is the labor of love of Matthew Ginsburg. Dr. Phil is notable for incorporating a lot of crossword-specific knowledge. It also paid more attention to the problem of searching through the constraint graph to find a good solution. Because you can't solve a crossword puzzle to find the optimal scoring solution in one go, you need some sort of heuristic search to fill the grid, hence the name Dr. Phil. So what happens when you write down one letter in a cell on the crossword? To make this a little bit more concrete, let's call this setting V to be F. When you do that, it has downstream effects on all of the nodes in the graph connected to that cell. So if you set this cell to T, then it constrains the answers to one across to be things like that, but, hot, or rat. And then 3 down has to be the, tat, tor, or tim, or something like that. So now the question is, should we do this? Is it a good idea to put T down in the cell? Let's take an equation from the Dr. Phil paper. The key here is this function rho. We'll talk more about what it is in a second, but for the moment, let's just say that it gives the compatibility between a clue and your candidate fill U. So this set here, D, represents all of the downstream consequences. These are the downstream fills U in the red boxes. Now there are lots of options here for each of these cells after you've made the assignment of T. So assume the best case scenario. In Dr. Phil, the objective function corresponds to the negative log probability. So the best case means minimizing all of the possible realizations of U that are still consistent with setting this one cell. Then you sum over all the cells that have some downstream consequence of the assignment that you're making. Searching through possibilities in the right order is important. For each clue, it keeps track of the gap between the first best answer and the next best answer. Remember how I started with the Judd Apatow clue here? Same idea. I'm pretty sure I know this. After I fill in Apatow, I can get the other clues around it. This should remind you of the buzzer module for answering pyramidal quiz bowl questions. Only buzz in when the score is high and there's a big gap between the top answer and the next answer. Then Dr. Phil goes to work. The biggest problem for Dr. Phil is an early mistake. Because everything is interconnected, a mistake early on can tempt Dr. Phil to make more and more mistakes. So to deal with this, Dr. Phil uses a variant of local discrepancy search. So here it says, I'm going to pretend that the section of the puzzle highlighted in red was a mistake, and say that I cannot use the guesses for these cells until I've exhausted all other options. It tries to complete the puzzle again with that constraint, and it sees if it gets a better overall score. Of course, you could keep doing that forever. So when does Dr. Phil know when to stop? Because the goal of Dr. Phil is to beat humans at crossword puzzle competitions, Dr. Phil stops when it hasn't been able to improve the score for a minute, an eternity for a computer. Or it has tried to improve all of the puzzle and failed, or it just has run out of regulation time. Over the course of a decade, Dr. Phil started being a fixture at in-person crossword tournaments, working its way up the charts, slowly improving every year with a slight dip in 2018, until it was clearly in the top 20s. Then, the in-person competition was canceled in 2020 for obvious reasons. The next step in the evolution of crosswords was a 2022 ACL paper by a team out of Berkeley that pushed computer crossword puzzle solvers over the finish line, winning the 2021 iteration of the American Crossword Puzzle Tournament. The Berkeley team combined forces with Matthew Ginsburg to combine Dr. Phil's search with their question-answering technology. And as a point of personal pride, Eric Wallace, pictured here, is my former student. I got him into the business of human versus computer question answering competitions with our 2018 Adversarial Quiz Bowl tournament, link in the description. So what was the contribution of the Berkeley team? Remember that the function in the Dr. Phil equation that said how good a clue matched an answer? The rho function, they replace that with a transformer language model, a lot like the closed book QA systems that we've talked about before. They have a dual encoder architecture. Given a clue that gets embedded in a low dimensional vector space, see how close it is to the encoding of a candidate answer. Train it over a bunch of crossword data and other QA examples, and to use my terminology, you get yourself a guesser to pair up with Dr. Phil's buzzer. Check out the video on DPR, dense passage retrieval, link in the description if you want to know more about how these sorts of systems work. Unlike classical DPR, though, they're not doing anything after the retrieval step. They're not doing the span selection afterwards. They're just finding the candidate answers, giving that to Dr. Phil to fill in. Apparently, the Berkeley folks only teamed up with Dr. Phil 2 weeks before the tournament, swapped out his guesser with their QA system. The combined system eked out a narrow victory over humans Eric Agard and Tyler Hinman, all scored in the 12,000 point range. After this victory, finally, Matthew Ginsburg declared that both he and Dr. Phil were retiring from crosswords. Normally, I don't talk about current events in my video, but as I record this on April 1st, 2022, the American Crossword Puzzle Tournament is starting up. Will there be a new computer champion? Will its victory be more decisive? Will Dr. Phil pull a Tom Brady and return from retirement? If you're in beautiful Stamford, Connecticut, check it out. They also usually have a stream online, so you could also check that out as well. Even if Dr. Phil's retirement means the end of computer crossword players, there is an important legacy here. The structure of this beautiful example of the Manchester paradigm is an important tool to connect the relationships between different questions. And remember, this is a fundamental problem in connecting conversational turns together. While crossword puzzles give you the structure of the relationships up front, perhaps the underlying math we saw here could help computers figure out how to connect up individual turns in a more free-form conversation. And filling out a crossword puzzle requires planning. Most question-answering systems don't have any plan. They just fill in the moment. If the score rises above a threshold, give the answer. But humans strategize when they have a conversation. They have things that they want. For example, in a Socratic dialogue, the teacher asks questions to bring a student along a particular path. But despite all of the incredible AI challenges of crossword puzzles, after you get a completed crossword puzzle, it's really easy to tell whether it's right or not. Every cell has a single letter, unless it's a rebus puzzle, and you either get the cell right or wrong. None of the craziness about evaluation that we talked about before comes into play. But just like how I think it was premature to declare computer trivia over after Watson won on Jeopardy, we haven't made crosswords that actually challenge computers. To see how we could trip up computers, consider this classic crossword puzzle from 1996. This was published the day of the American election, and either Bob Dole or Clinton works as the answer to 39 across. And all of the other clues work as well. 39 down, black Halloween animal, can either be cat or bat. 42 down, much debated political initials, is ERA, Equal Rights Amendment, for the E in Bob Dole, and NRA, National Rifle Association, for the N in Clinton. Will Shorts really outdid himself here, as these political initialisms are on both sides of the political aisle, just like Bill Clinton and Bob Dole. So the way to ramp up the difficulty for computers is to make the search space more challenging, to put implausible fills that lead the computer down a wrong but plausible path so that the search to correct the error takes forever. Like in this puzzle, you might think that Star Wars is the better of the two sci-fi franchises, and given that Star Wars is obviously wrong here, the system would need to backtrack to undo this mistake. But you could also up the difficulty of the clues as well. Britain's cryptic crosswords do this, or by adding a theme to the underlying puzzle. But as the mastermind of Dr. Phil said, what's important
is how differently the computer solves crosswords. So you see in the video there the speed with which it's actually checking its work here, and it just flashes through things. It doesn't solve them sort of a word at a time like people do. And I think it's important to realize that machines and people generally solve problems very differently. And what that means going forward, I think, is totally good news. We're going to be good at one set of things, machines are going to be good at another set of things, and we'll manage to solve problems together that neither of us could solve separately. And, you know, we're not looking at the Terminator, we're looking at a collaborator and a partner.
To make that vision happen, let's create adversarial crossword puzzles that challenge machines by making the search space more complicated. This could only happen with humans and computers working together to write the crosswords. And someday, we may get to a point where it takes a human and a computer working as a team to solve such a fiendishly difficult crossword puzzle. And when that happens, I'll be in the front row. This is just a single lecture from a course. YouTube likes to show you these videos out of order, but if you go to the course webpage linked below, you can see the lectures in the right order, and you can get resources like homeworks or suggested reading. You can also visit quanta.org if you want to learn about our systems for creating computers that can answer questions, where Quanta stands for Question Answering Is Not a Trivial Activity. If you want to help the channel, provide a big gradient to the algorithm by liking and subscribing.